Devlog number 4. Kept you waiting, huh? December has been quite a busy month for me. I finally finished my office. I now have more work surface than ever. A bunch of storage for all my mess. Plants and furnitures to put my many statues, Legos and souvenirs away from the dust. Too bad not every statue I own fits in. But that's just me finding excuses for not posting a devlog for a month. Let's discover how I went from this to this. In this devlog, I'm going to talk about day-night cycles, the terrain, water, and level design. Let's go! Since I have sort of a dynamic lighting and I'm able to tweak any color in the scene, it only takes a few minutes to create a nice mood. I don't know for you, but I love how some games handle the dawn and dusk, especially when they take some creative liberties with colors. The first thing I noticed is that the beauty in those visuals rely a lot on the fog. I didn't use the default 3.js fog, which uses the depth, and instead I implemented a custom solution using the distance from the focus point so that we can get a round area and some fog near the camera too. I'm not sure I will keep that, but let's stick to it for now. Since the day and night cycles are going to affect many components, I created a class in which I increment a progress value that goes from 0 to 1 again and again. The first thing I used the day and night cycles for was the light position. Even though it's not realistic, there is only one light source, the sun, and it's always visible even at night. The trick is that its trajectory is doing some kind of circles, but always in the same general direction. Very low at night, so that we get spooky shadows, and higher in the sky during the day. And it's never right behind the camera, so that we always have a nice shading. But obviously, having the sun near the horizon doesn't look like it's the night. I needed to tweak some values. I built a keyframe system able to interpolate any number or color according to the progress I previously mentioned. First, I created the four presets corresponding to the main phases of the day. The day, the dusk, the night, and the dawn. And I put every color and number that could change during the cycle. Things like the light color, light intensity, fog color, fog intensity, shadow multiplier, etc. Next, I created some keyframes based on those presets. As you can see, I use the same presets for multiple keyframes because I don't want the value to change all the time. When it's midday, the sun moves, but we can't see much of a difference in terms of color. Next, it was a matter of using those interpolated properties in the various components. And there we go. And obviously, I have full control over the presets, but also on how the day and night progresses. I don't know how fast the day and night cycles should go. I initially thought of having it match where I live right now, but that would mean some people at the opposite side of the planet would need to wake up in the middle of their night to see my portfolio in the day. Not great. Maybe a cycle lasting a few minutes is better suited. I will sleep on that. As many of you mentioned while seeing the previous iterations, that's a nice grass, but there is too much of it. And I agree. It was time to implement some terrain variations. I started from a texture in which I use each channel for different purpose. I'm not going to explain how I draw that texture just yet, but I can tell you that the green channel is used for the grass and the blue channel is used for the water. The red channel and alpha channels are not used right now, but I'm sure I will need it eventually. In a terrain class, I created a TSL node retrieving the data color from that texture according to a 2D coordinate, and I created another TSL node retrieving the actual color of the terrain according to that data color. I can now use the data texture to control things such as the grass and later the depth of the terrain, and I can use the actual color to display nice color variations such as dirt, grass, but also water areas. And as always, I can tweak those colors. I also use that same color for the light bounce. Check the previous devlogs for more info about that. Those are great colors, but there is currently no depth to that water. I could have used the terrain data color to display the floor geometry, but I also needed something for the physics. Since I'm using Rapier, there is a cool collider class named HateField, which is perfect for this scenario. The HateField consists of a succession of hate values that will be used as a grid. It's not an actual mesh where you can move each vertex on the XYZ coordinates. You only provide one hate value per grid intersection, which makes it more performant, but the main downside is that we can't have holes in that terrain. Not a big deal for me. Using the node geometry modifier in Blender, I moved the vertices of a plane according to the terrain data texture. I exported it using the Draco compression, which is doing quite an amazing job in this case. I imported it in the portfolio, and after some mathematic struggles, I managed to recreate the hate field. And since I already load the terrain geometry, why not use it as an actual floor mesh? Currently, the plane consists of 266 by 266 vertices for the same surface size. It might be more than what I need, but I don't know how big and precise that terrain should be. So I will just keep it like that for now. I love to work on stylized water. There are so many tricks, and even simple and performant solutions can look really good. Since I want good performance, forget about things such as fluid simulation, refraction, or ray tracing. The first thing I added was a subtle gradient starting from the water surface and toward the bottom on any objects that could fall in the water. It's pure illusion, but we start to notice where the surface of the water is. The next effect I really wanted to have was ripples going from the middle of the water areas toward the shore. I created a large plane always below the vehicle and always filling the view. I used the terrain data texture blue channel as a reference to know how far from the shore the surface is. Using a modulo, I made that value loop from 0 to 1. I used the time to make that pattern move toward the shore. I remapped the value so that the pattern gets bigger while getting close to the shore. I used a perlin texture to add some variations. And I discarded the pixel when the value is greater than a specific threshold. At this stage, the ripples look really good, but the pattern is always the same. To fix that, I first rounded the ripple progress value so that I could get kind of a ripple index. First one is 0, then 1, then 2, and it goes on and on like that. I then added a little offset to where I picked the color from the perlin noise texture according to that ripple index. And there we go. Not gonna lie, I love watching those little ripples. It feels peaceful and mesmerizing. I started working on splashes, reflections, and things like that, but I didn't want to add too much for performance reasons, but also to keep it visually simple. I will very likely add more to it, but not now. For the physics, since anything below the ground surface is considered as in the water, I simply inverted the gravity when an object's Y position is below the water surface. And the further down, the stronger the object is being pulled out of the water. And just like that, objects started to float and oscillate on the water surface. But obviously, that became a problem for the vehicle. We can't accelerate if none of the wheels are touching a surface. To fix that, I tested that the vehicle was in the water using its Y position again. If the vehicle is in the water, I enable what I call the water controls. When water controls is active, using the left and right inputs makes the vehicle turn, and using the forward and backward inputs apply a force on the vehicle regardless of the wheels touching the surface or not. I got some funny little bugs, but at the end we can control the vehicle quite easily, like a boat. It's not perfect and it's still hard to get the vehicle out of the water, especially when it's upside down, but I'm sure I will find ways to improve that. A A classic issue when creating a complex world is how hard it is to iterate. In order to be creative, you need to be able to tweak things fast. That's why we have the debug UI, and that's also why I needed to have a level editor. I thought of creating an actual level editor by creating a side app, but adding any new feature would imply updating both the main application and the level editor application, which would make the process even longer. Instead, I decided to use Blender. I was already using it to create models, and it's extremely flexible, especially if you know Python. For the terrain, I created four separated textures that I then merged into one using the compositor. Because yes, in Blender you can render an image while applying some node magic to that image. I used the same color in order to visualize the result directly in Blender, and even reproduced the grass using geometry node. I can now edit the whole terrain using the Blender Paint tool, and all I need to do is a little compositor render to export the final terrain data texture for three.js. Some components in my portfolio are repeated all over the place, like the bushes or the bricks. Let's focus on the bricks. I created a visual version, which is the final model, and a reference version, which is a simplified version that I linked duplicate a bunch of times. A linked duplicate is what we would call instancing in three.js, where the same geometry is used for multiple instances. Modifying one will modify the others. I then exported the visual and the references separately and loaded them in three.js. The cool part here is that Blender and its GLTF exporter support instancing, resulting in a quite small file for references. I used the instance mesh 3.js class to create the final mesh in 3.js. Instance mesh enables drawing the same geometry multiple times according to different transformation matrices with very good performance. In other words, hundreds of the same geometry with a good frame rate. And I used the references model to set those matrices. It works for the bricks and for the bushes. Let's add some flowers. In Blender, I used a single rounded plane to visualize them. In 3.js, I loaded those references, and at the place of each reference, I created a cluster of rounded planes, again using the instance mesh. I used the same foliage texture as for the bushes, and also changed the color between each cluster. I updated that foliage texture to add variations between the leaves, and why not make them glow in the night using the day and night cycle progress. Let's keep going. We have bushes and flowers. How about we add some trees? I created a visual version in Blender. Use the same references technique with a low poly version, and recreated the trees in 3.js using the classic instance mesh. And for the leaves, I used bushes. Yep, those are bushes high up in the trees. And the best part is that we can have a different color. Those trees add so much contrast and depth to the scene. I love it. For the physics, let me give you a little secret. I only created a cylinder at the base of the tree. In this current state, I can iterate very fast. It's not perfect. I might be able to automate some more stuff, but I can add objects there, paint water here, grow some trees over there, which is going to get super handy. And that's it for the devlog. I will keep adding more stuff to the environment, maybe start working on weather hazard and also on controls. I want the portfolio to be playable on desktop, mobile, but also using a controller. And I have some cool ideas I want to try out. Don't forget to follow me on X or Blue Sky for granular updates. Happy New Year and late Merry Christmas for everybody it concerns. And I will see you in the next devlog.